Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse has swung into theaters, so today I'm going to be stopping and ranking all 10 Spider-Man films, as well as the two Venom films, from the worst to the best. Hello everyone, it's Ledger Forever, and as I just said, I am ranking all 12 Spider-Man and Venom films. And this franchise is pretty good considering some of the films that are at the bottom I can still watch, even though I'm not a very big fan of the one at the bottom and part of the one that's next. But with all that said, let's get started into my ranking. In last place for me is Venom Let There Be Carnage. And this just has no excuse for how lame and boring it is. There's not very much action in the film, and I just really did not buy into some of the stuff. I don't really think that the couple, I can't even remember her name, that was the girlfriend of Eddie Brock in the beginning of the original one who broke up with him. I don't think they even have very good chemistry together. They're not a romance I could buy into. Woody Harrelson he's okay as Carnage, but one of my major criticisms for this film is because it's PG-13, we don't get to see much carnage of what Carnage can do. It's in the name Carnage, which means like chaos and mayhem. Which means that we don't even get to see him do that. Why? Because it's PG-13. Why did they do that? They just did it so they could get a higher profit. And that was just lazy. They should have made the Venom movies rated R. Because then we actually get to see Venom eating heads. And also maybe drop a few F-bombs without them getting censored by loud noises. That would be funny. And I just really didn't care for this movie. There's some moments in here I do like. But overall, it's a movie that it was such a disappointment for me was because I had heard so many people say it was better than the original. A friend of mine had said it was better. He has a YouTube channel as well, Jay Lewis. And also, think about Sean Chandler says it's better. Rotten Tomatoes says it better. Most fans will say Venom Let There Be Carnage is better. And it was not. I was not a fan of it at all. And it was just a very big disappointment for me. At number 11, Venom. And I wasn't the biggest fan of this movie either. Because I had always been really excited to watch it. As soon as it came to Disney Plus, I was there. Because I had always wanted to see the movie. And I just thought that it was going to be a really good movie where we got to see Venom causing chaos in a PG-13 way. And was it that? No, there's lots of exposition in the movie. It's not very interesting. I wasn't very compelled to it. I do think the bromance between Eddie and Venom is hilarious a lot, but it's just not something that I would rarely, like, it's a movie that I would rarely just, like, want to rewatch. Meanwhile, some of the other ones on this list, I would really like to rewatch. And I mean, I know this movie has its fans. I mean, this one has a very low percent of Rotten Tomatoes. It's in the 30s. But it's just not a movie that I would say is really good like some of the others on here. I mean, the story in here is probably better. Riot, I think, was always a better villain kind of than Carnage. I just don't know why. I couldn't tell you if I wanted to. I just think that he was a better villain. I don't really know why, because I think the way that Riot is killed was a better way to be killed than it was for Carnage, where he's just eaten. And, Riot dies in a way where he's blown up by his own creation. Meanwhile, Carnage is just eaten alive by Venom, and then he bites the head off of Cletus Kasady after he says that he just wanted to be friends with him, which was kind of just, are you kidding me? Did you seriously went there? So I have some fun with this. There are some moments I like, but if I had to say my favorite part, and I'm not gonna say the end credits, well, kind of bam. I'm gonna say when they put out the trailers teasing Into the Spider-Verse, which you will see dramatically higher on this list. Bringing us into the top 10, Spider-Man 3. The best, the worst of the Spider-Man films, but dramatically higher than Venom and Venom Let There Be Carnage. There's a, like a there's a big leap in quality from Venom to Spider-Man 3. And I do enjoy Spider-Man 3 quite a bit. I don't think we've had a bad Spider-Man film. Venom, we've had two, both films. Hopefully the third one will be a step up. But I do think that there's some good moments here. Like, I should Venom be in this movie? That's a debate. Is Sandman a good villain? Yes. And he's one of my favorite of the Spider-Man villains. He's a very compelling person. He's not even a bad guy. He's just someone who wanted to help his daughter. And that's a really tragic thing. But I will say Topher Grace, he is one of the worst casting choices and possibly the worst casting choice I have ever seen in any of these Spider-Man movies and Venom movies. He does not fit the part of Venom at all. And Venom doesn't even show up till like almost 30 minutes until the movie's over. And the way that they kill him was very anticlimactic. Just they strap a Green Goblin bomb to him and then he goes inside it like, no, because that is so stupid. And that was just suicide. He basically just killed himself on purpose. Because what was he going to do as soon as he got inside Venom? Because he would have been blown up anyway. But I will say one of the major criticisms of it was the emo Peter Parker dance. Was it as cringy for you as it was for me? Was it as cringy on your end as it was for me? Yeah, I thought so. But I do still think that there's some fun to be had here. Fun fact, this was the first Spider-Man film I ever watched. For the Raimi trilogy, I watched them in the backwards order. I watched Spider-Man 3, then I watched Spider-Man 2, then a while later I watched the original. And you will see both 1 and 2 way higher on the list. But I do still have some fun with this movie, but is it the worst in the trilogy? Yes. And one of the main reasons was because MJ, I was fine with her in the original. The second one, I just really did not like her. I cannot stand her in this movie. She is one of my least favorite movie characters ever. I cannot stand her. She's always complaining in this movie. She literally in the second film said that she wanted to help Peter and that she wanted and that she knew there was going to be risks and that she knew that he was Spider-Man so she could understand. Did she not remember that thing? She is always complaining in this film. She is always making like so many things that are harder on Peter. Always saying there's a literal scene in the movie where she says, "This is not about you. This is about me." I just cannot stand her when she does stuff like that. So I do have fun with this movie, but I really wish that they could have just like dropped an anvil on her head or something. At number 9, Spider-Man Far From Home. One of the most controversial movies inside the MCU and one of the ones that people, you either love it or you hate it. There are people that say that it's like a bottom 5 MCU movie, and there are people that would probably say that's like almost a top 5 MCU movie. I think it's like right there in the middle for me. I do think this is a good movie, but I do think that there's some problems here. Like, right off the bat, I think that it was a terrible idea for what they did with the glasses and Peter. Basically, the premise of it is that a Tony Stark entrusted millions of dollars in glasses that could kill people to a high schooler who had proven to be immature with weapons before, who was dead for 5 years without any supervision, without any instructions, nothing. So that is a glaring hole in it that makes you think, why would they do that? That is so stupid. Like, we know that Tony doesn't always make the best decisions, but we think that he should have been smart enough to think, okay, that's a bit weird. And the reason that he shouldn't have done it is because he then gives the glasses to the very person he wasn't supposed to be giving them to. Although, to be fair, he didn't know that he wasn't supposed to be giving him to Mysterio. But still. And also, this is the 7th time. No, actually, I think it's the... Well, it's the 7th MCU movie where a villain is motivated by scorn or anger against Tony Stark. Hey, baby, one more time. which, I mean, I know that Tony is not the most likable guy half the time. Believe me, I do. I mean, he's not even my favorite Avenger. Cap is, but I think that he needs to dial it back a bit because he is making way too many people angry. I mean, I'm pretty sure that we've now hit our limit for people who are now going to be motivated by scorn for him because he's now been dead for several years he's been dead for like 4 or 5. So I don't think any more people would be able to use him as an excuse. Maybe in like Kang Dynasty or Secret Wars with maybe a multiverse thing, but still. But I do think that there's some fun to be had here. I think it's a good when it's like a high school like comedy movie on a road trip. That's fun. But when it just goes into like those bad ideas I just talked about, it just loses me. At number 8, The Amazing Spider-Man 2. Now, I know this is way too high for a lot of people, because I know a lot of you really hate this, but for me, I do enjoy it. Andrew Garfield is probably my favorite of the Spider-Man. It's either him or Tobey. They regularly switch. But I just have to say, I've always had fun with The Amazing Spider-Man movies, and all that's really helped out by the fact that Peter Parker and Gwen Stacy, aka Andrew Garfield and Emma Stone, have fantastic chemistry together. You could really buy into the fact that that they could be an actual couple, partly because I think they were. I think they actually became a couple after these movies, which is hilarious considering it. That's why they're so nice to each other. And this feels a lot more personal when you get to like the third act because the fact that Gwen's life is being put on the line, and there will be spoilers coming in 3, 2, 1, and as soon as Gwen dies, that's when it gets really emotional, just seeing how he could have saved her, and he almost did, because he had the web on her, and you notice that her head's going down a bit, and you're like, oh no, she's about to die, and then her head hits the floor, and you are just, it gives you a punch in the face, and the worst thing about it is he promised Gwen's dad in the first one that he wouldn't let anything happen to her. That's the thing that gets me the most in this movie. The fact that he broke something. That always gets to me, and I really like it. Andrew, as usual, you can tell he's having fun being funny, being the smart aleck with these criminals. He always likes to do that. He is the one that likes to joke around with the criminals. Like, Tom would occasionally do it. Tobey, he didn't really joke around with the criminals that much. He was always more of the, like, serious of them. But I really enjoyed this movie. I do think there's a lot of, there can be villain overload at times, because you just get there's a scene where we get Rhino, who is a terrible villain, where you just see him go like, which is just dumb. And I know a lot of people crack on the Green Goblin in that film and Electro. Personally, I like Electro. He's an okay villain in that one. I'm not the biggest fan of the Green Goblin in that one, but hey, I really like this movie. Most of the fact is because Emma Stone and Andrew Garfield are such amazing together. But I am more likely to watch it than I am to watch Far From Home, Spider-Man 3, Venom, and Venom Let There Be Carnage. At number 7, The Amazing Spider-Man. And the first film with Andrew Garfield in it, like I said, Andrew Garfield is probably my favorite of the Spider-Men. He's definitely my favorite Spider-Man. Tobey's by far the best of the Peter Parkers. And I would say this one does the best job at, like, how should I say this? It shows the personal, it shows kind of the origin part of, actually, no, I'm just going to say it shows the origin of his parents, kind of. I know a lot of people crack on that part a lot, but I think it's kind of interesting. In the second, we get more in depth about that, and I really enjoy just the way that he becomes Spider-Man. This, they do have to reframes. I mean, I know this film got criticized a lot, mostly because it came out in 2012, so blah blah blah. It came out a few years after Spider-Man 3, so you don't usually do a reboot a few years after you have a film that was pretty controversial. But anyway, I liked it a lot.
I like it a lot.
And I do think it's really good. And would I say it's great? Probably not. But, like I said before, with The Amazing Spider-Man 2, and this one especially, Emma Stone and Andrew Garfield have fantastic chemistry together. You really buy into their couple. And they, like, Gwen Stacy's easily the best Spider-Man girlfriend we have ever gotten. No competition. No competition at all. And I just always liked how she is kind of the person that she can be almost the damsel in distress sometimes, but she can always hold her own. I mean, there are some times she couldn't, because keep in mind she doesn't have superpowers. That was the reason she was killed in the second, because she fell through the tower. But I mean, she's really powerful in her own way. Like, she is not always afraid of these villains. She actually sometimes will taunt them, but I really like how she's easily the bravest of them. It's either her or the one, Tom Holland's MJ. Those two are the most brave ones, and I really always liked Gwen Stacy. I always liked her as my favorite. She was always so nice, and also she's the one that helps Peter out with his missions, like, the most. She helped him in the first movie get rid of the virus that was going to turn everyone into lizards, which brings us to Lizard, who I wasn't the biggest fan of him. I thought he was good, but there was some stuff in there I just thought was, like, too generic and stuff we had seen many times before. So it wasn't always the most fresh, but I still enjoyed it for what it was, and it was a good movie. Bringing us into the top 5, Spider-Man Homecoming. And this works best for me when it's a high school movie, which is just really good. And when it goes to superhero mode, I can really have some fun with it. No Way Home and Homecoming regularly will, like, switch around a bit, because I'll tell you why. One of my big criticisms for No Way Home when we get there, but I do have a lot of fun with this movie. I do think that there are some points in which it, like, kind of drags, gets slow, or just I can nitpick a bit of it. Vulture is one of the greatest villains in Marvel. I will fight and die on that hill. He's probably my second favorite, other than, of course, Thanos. But if I've never been the biggest fan of some of the other MCU villains, they've had a lot of really bad ones, but Vulture is just one of those ones that he's not even really a villain. He's just someone that wants to protect his family that's starting to do villainous stuff. Wait, did I just contradict myself? Okay, fair to get that part. Then, anyway, also Tony Stark getting to be in this. I really like that he's not even one of the main characters. He's more of, like, this side character that's coming up and, like, teaching Peter some stuff. And he's more of a father figure in this one, which I always loved. Because Tony, he was always my favorite when he was being the father figure to Peter. I always just loved that relationship between them. And it made it so fun and interesting. And there's some really good comedy moments in here. I think Tom Holland's the weakest of the Spider-Men. He's my third favorite Spider-Man ever. But I would still say he is really fun. And there is some stuff I would say I can nitpick a bit. But overall, it's a really fun movie. And one of my favorites of 2017. At number 6, oh man, I'm about to get a lot of heat for this. Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse. I do enjoy this movie quite a bit. This is the new one, and I do think that there's some really cool moments in this movie. This is always very stunning animation, and that's one of my criticisms of it. It's so amazing, the painting of it, and it just looks so distracting at times, like, especially in Gwen's universe, probably only Gwen's universe, the color changes so regularly, and it just looks so, so abnormal and weird. It's almost distracting. I'm always like, okay, can we just go back to, like, normal colors? It looks so weird the way, I don't even know if I may be the only one that noticed that, but I just really could not get over that part. But I do think that there's some really good moments in here. There's some really good action sequences in this movie, and there is a lot of really funny scenes in here. It's the part one of a two-parter, so that's cool. So what is wrong with me today? It ends on a cliffhanger, which is good. Peter B. Parker is less in this movie. He's, like, less in the story in it. And I always liked him into the Spider-Verse more because he was more of a main character. Meanwhile, this season more of a side character. I was never the biggest fan of Gwen in these movies. I just never liked her too much. I always loved Peter B. Parker, and Miles was okay. I wasn't the biggest fan of him. I've always felt he was overrated and kind of annoying sometimes. Again, maybe the only one that noticed that, but I do really love the scene where we actually get a cameo of Andrew and Toby, and they actually do have a callback to Tom Holland in a certain scene that is a callback to Spider-Man Homecoming. If you've seen the movie, you know what I mean. There's some really good moments in here. But there's just some stuff in here I just either can't get over or can criticize a bit. At number 4, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. I do have a lot of fun with this movie. It's very funny. It's probably the funniest of all the Spider-Man movies. It's definitely on the funnier side. It's really good at balancing comedy as well as sometimes drama and also action and adventure. And I really like that Peter B. Parker is more of the main focus of this movie than Gwen. Like I said, wasn't always the biggest fan of her. The animation in this movie is stunning. There was nothing like this animation quality. This was like the first film to do that I can think of. Then it started coming back into more common things like TMNT. The new one has done animation like this. Same thing with Puss in Boots, The Last Wish. And the new Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse and then Beyond the Spider-Verse is going to do it, so. And I really just have this movie good. Here's why I won't put it higher. I will say this. Just get ready. I will fight all of you in the comments below if I have to. I think it's overrated.
Yeah, well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man.
It is very overrated. I see regularly people saying it's like the best animated movie of all time, the best comic book movie of all time, it's better than The Dark Knight, it's the greatest movie of all time. Nope, 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 and nope. And in that order, I do not think it is any of those things. It is not the greatest animated movie of all time. It is not the greatest movie of all time. And just, like, how? I mean, it just gets so much praise for stuff that it does not deserve. Like, there are a lot. I still have 3 more Spider-Man movies I like more than this. And is there some stuff in here I really like? Yes. But is there stuff in here that I can get in the other movies? Yes, for some things. And do people give it too much credit for stuff that it doesn't deserve half the time? Yes. So I will say it's a good movie, but the reason I wouldn't put it higher is because people have overrated it so much, saying it's like the greatest movie ever. And believe me, I've found some people that say it's the greatest movie ever. It is not, and I would say that it's kind of souring my taste with the movie every time people say that. But I then like watch the film and I'll say that was a really good movie, and it's in the top 5 Spider-Man movies, but it can't be it cannot be top 3 because of how much people overrate it. Bringing us into the top 3. Spider-Man No Way Home. I know a lot of people hate this film because I've met some people that don't like it. They say it's a horrible comic book film. I've even met someone who's brave enough to say Batman and Robin was better than this. And I just understand none of that. I think this film is amazing. This is top tier MCU. Here's why I like it. Yes, it's fan service, but keep in mind, this is fan service for the Spider-Man. We get to see Andrew. We get to see Toby again. All two. Sorry. We get to see both of them. And we get to see all 3 of them interacting yet another. They have such amazing chemistry. Just the way they can bounce off each other, compliment each other, and just do certain funny things together. And how they're like comparing each other and how their universes are different. And how they fought people and how Andrew's like, oh man, I think he insulted himself saying something along the lines of, oh, I'm boring because Toby has fought a symbiote, which is an alien, and also Tom has fought a purple alien. And he's like, oh man, I want to fight an alien. And then he talks about how he fought a rhino once, which means he's comparing himself to what happens in The Amazing Spider-Man 2, where he says, man, I fought a Russian guy in a rhino suit. So I'm like, I'm boring compared to you. That is hilarious. And it's just, I've always enjoyed getting to see them together. So getting to see all 3 together playing off each other, I wasn't always the biggest fan of Doctor Strange in these movies. But because Doctor Strange is one of my least favorite of the Avengers. I just never liked him very much. He's very unlikable sometimes. There's the reason that it cannot be higher on this list is because the central premise is that Peter Parker goes to Doctor Strange, and Doctor Strange, without asking if he had contacted college, already starts a spell to wipe millions of people's memory. That just never made sense. It's kind of like Far From Home, just in a different way. They do something very lazy, and they also do something very stupid. So I do really like this movie, but there's just some stuff I would nitpick about it. But I do really like it. For a while, it was actually my favorite movie of all time. It has gone down way more because it's not, probably isn't, I don't think it's even in my top 30. None of Marvel is in my top 30. Maybe in my top 40. But for those, I usually just reserve like pure action movies or pure comedy movies. But I do really enjoy this movie. Our runner-up, Spider-Man 2. And here we get a really good sequel, and a lot of people say this tops the original. I'm not a person that would say that. I love this movie, but I love the sequel. I love the original too. It's one of the best origin stories ever made. And this one, since we already have Peter Parker's origin out of the way, we can already dive into things like we get to see him, how he's struggling as Peter Parker with Spider-Man. We get a lot more depth into him than the first one. So we get we're seeing how he's failing in a lot of his stuff. He's trying to find a girlfriend, and there's actually some really funny moments in this one too. This is definitely the funniest in the Sam Raimi trilogy. Spider-Man 3 does have funny moments, but they're usually replaced then right after like that with cringy moments. Like I said, with the emo Peter Parker thing, which I'm not a big fan of, even though it is one of the most memed things ever made. But I do think that there's a lot of really fun stuff here, but I wouldn't say it's my favorite just because MJ is starting to show her true colors of being so annoying in this movie. I mean, she's nowhere near as bad as she is in 3. 3, they took her from like 7 or 8, where she is in this movie, 7 or 8, they take her up to 85. And it just makes you want to strangle her. And you can pop. And I've seen some moments in here where I just want to strangle her. But I do have a lot of fun with this movie, a lot. Alfred Molina's Doc Ock, one of the best. He's my second favorite villain inside He's my second favorite Spider-Man villain. And is he a really good villain? Yes. Is he a tragic villain? Yes. That's why he's so amazing. And another reason why it's not number one, I just never bought into the fact that Peter Parker is losing his powers of being Spider-Man because he's bummed out. That just never sat right with me. I wasn't the biggest fan of that. But other than that, it's a really, really good movie. But in first place, Spider-Man. The origin story, the original, the OG, the first, whatever you need to call it. I love this movie. This is a top 10 superhero movie ever. It is. It has like a bit of comedy. Just this is one of the more serious movies. It can do some really cool things. It's the one that I can think of the most scenes in either this one or No Way Home are the ones that I can think of the most. It's not the one I've rewatched the most because I saw it for the first time not long ago, but I loved it when I saw it. And this is one of my favorite origin stories ever. I'm an origin story guy. Origin stories are my favorite part about superhero films, usually. That's why I love films like Batman Begins, Guardians of the Galaxy, Iron Man, Spider-Man. All of them are origin stories, which are just so amazing to me. And there's some stuff in here that I know some people aren't the biggest fan of. They can nitpick about it. I really like it. Willem Dafoe is amazing as Green Goblin in it. So he is such a really cool villain. Like, can Spider-Man come out to play? Which he says in this one, which they then give a callback to in No Way Home, where they say it again. And he is a really good villain, and he can do some really despicable things too. And I also think that MJ's a lot more tolerable in this one. She is way more tolerable in this one than she is in Spider-Man 2 and 3. If you took away half of her annoyingness in both films, then subtracted each of it, then she would be a lot better than she was. I really I can stand her in this movie. She's nice. I mean, she's a lot nicer because she's... You can tell that she's, like, having a hard time because her parents are, like, really big fighters. You can see that in a certain scene, but... I know that it's really funny for some things that they will do, and I do think that it's a really good origin story. It's great. It's amazing. So, for that reason, it comes in at number one. So, thank you all so much for watching my ranking of the Spider-Man movies. Please like and subscribe if you're not already. I am begging you. Actually, okay, no, I'm not going to beg you, but please do. It really helps me out. I'm trying to reach my goal of 100 subscribers, and then let's see if we can make that happen, because that would be so amazing. I never thought I would be able to get to 94. This is such an accomplishment. Thank you all so much for this. This has always been a dream of mine, and you guys are helping me fulfill that dream, and you guys are all the best. Thank you all so much for watching this. Have a good one.